Now this wonderful Sunday afternoon, there's a great word that the Lord has given unto me. That for us to move and get into the place where God has instructed us to be, there are some 5 basic principles of life that you are about to hear, and you're about to walk with it, and you're about to be maintained on the level of God. Look into the face of the Lord and say,
My neighbor.
You need
these five
principles. Said to God, hear me, never forget about these 5 principles. This evening, I'm not going to scream, I'm not going to shout, I'm not going to jump, I'm not going to holler. I'm going to speak to us in the form of teaching. You are going to know the 5 life principles from the Bible. If you know these 5 principles, Church of God, hear me, you'll be able to stay on top.
Amen.
Oh, I didn't hear that. Amen. Not only will you be able to stay on top, but you'll be able to move in life.
Amen.
And get advantages.
Amen.
You'll be able to walk into the place of power and the place of dominion.
Amen.
Somebody say 5 principles.
5 principles.
Because he's teaching, I want the place very, very active and secure for me very, very well. Because I'm going to get time and teach us 5 basic life principles. Church of God, hear me. You standing here, if you don't know, the original you is not the one here. The original you is your spirit. When we talk about you, it's not you standing here. Original you is your spirit. You are and you were a spirit, and God gave you this body. So this body is only a secondary matter. We know how to grow our bodies. We grow our bodies by eating good food and by drinking good medicine. But we all forget that original us is our spirit. And how do we grow our spirit? If your spirit is grown well, your body is very active. But if you only feed your body without feeding your spirit, you are in big danger. At the end of the day, your body not be located anymore. That's why when somebody dies, they say the body is here and the person is gone. So which means the original person is not the body. The original you is your spirit. And these 5 biblical principles are the one that is going to help you to build your spirit. And this one will build both your spirit and also your physical man, so that you'll be able to move to the place where you belong in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I want us to open our Bibles to the gospel according to St. Luke. And all the teachings of Jesus Christ, they are being given to us for us to have a good life. And Luke chapter 15, they are being given to us for us to have a good life. And because of the good life that the teachings of Jesus Christ have been given to us, most of the time, 15 verse 8, most of the time, as a matter of fact, Jesus speaks in principles and also in parables. But we take the eye of the Spirit and by the power of revelation for you to know what Jesus Christ is talking about. This is a particular scripture that many people know about it, but we're about to use it to get the 5 principles of life. Amen. Luke chapter 15, reading from the verse of 8, and give me NIV and let's read it together. Luke chapter 15, reading from the verse of 8, give me the NIV and let's read it together. 1, 2, 3, let's go. Loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? Verse 9. And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together. Rejoice with me, I found my lost coin. Verse 10. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God. What sin? Will repent. Let's go back to it again. Now hear me. These are the 5 principles. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. What does she do? These are the principles of life. Number 1. Does she not light a lamp? Somebody say light.
Light.
Sweep the house. Number 2 says sweep.
Sweep.
Number 3 says search.
Search.
Number 4. Go to 9. Number 4, say friends.
Friends.
And number 5, say family.
Family.
Let's go back together again. It's this scripture that has all the answers. 8. Somebody say light.
Light. Lies.
Somebody say sweep.
Sweep.
Somebody say search.
Search.
Now somebody say friends.
Friends.
Somebody say family.
Family.
Now look into the face of your neighbor and say,
My neighbor.
These are
the five principles
for your elevation. Say,
My neighbor.
I beg you, never. Do not forget
about these
biblical five principles.
They will help you
to find what you are looking for. Close your eyes for a word of prayer. Father, give to us mysteries and give to us revelations. So at the end of the day, we will come together and say, God, you are a good God and you are a great God. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Son of the living God.
Amen.
Shall we be seated in the presence of the living God? I want to speak for very, very few minutes, using as a subject your five basic life principles. Put your hand on your heart and say,
These are
my five basic
life principles.
One writer by the name of C.S. Lewis, he was a great ancient writer. He made a statement. He says, it's through hardships that change and prepare people who are ordinary into extraordinary destinies. It's through hardship that change an ordinary person into an extraordinary destiny. Life is designed in such a way that a day and a time will come where you are supposed to fight. Anybody who tells you you are not supposed to fight in life is not telling you the truth. Life is designed in such a way that every now and then there's going to be a contention. And this kind of contentions will come from different places and sometimes places where you yourself didn't believe the contention will come from. You can plan your life very well, making sure that all is well. And all of a sudden, somebody who doesn't know their left or right can come and cross you. So that what you have planned all your life, their assignment is for it to come to an abrupt end. So in order for you to be very careful, what you need to do is to plan your life. It will be very, very, very unfair for you to only know things about the spirit without knowing what to do in the physical. And it's also very dangerous when you only know things from the physical without knowing things of the spirit. It's very good that we go to school. It's very good we have secular education. But church of God, hear me, secular education without Christ can lead you into crisis. One ancient father of the faith made another statement. He says, secular education is barren. It's always in labor, but it never gives birth. I'm repeating one more time. Secular education is barren. It's always in labor, but it never gives birth. In other words, it's always in labor, but it never produces good results. The same people who are causing corruption in our world have their PhD. The same people carry their masters. And those are the same people who are causing the world to be in a mess. Life without Christ will lead you into crisis. But I came to speak to somebody right now that the moment you call yourself the child of God, your life is supposed to be an example to somebody.
Yeah.
It's not only the only thing you need to do is only say, I'm a Christian without your character showing somebody.
Yes.
There is one man from India, he's dead and gone. He died in 30th of January 1948. He was born in 2nd of October 1869. The name of the man is called Mahatma Gandhi. And this particular man is the one who led the people of India to come out from slavery in the time of the British Empire, when they were under the colonial rule of the British Empire. And this man said, we are come to come out from the rule of the British, but not with fights, but we are going to do everything peaceful. And one day, one writer who walked to this particular man by the name of Mahatma Gandhi said, "Mahatma Gandhi, we know that you are not a Christian, and we know that you are a Hindu man. But anytime you are speaking, you begin to speak about Jesus. You begin to quote about Christ. But you speak about Christ, but why are you not a Christian?" And the name of this person who asked Mahatma Gandhi this question is called Stanley Jones. He was a missionary. He says, "You like quoting Jesus, but you say you don't want to be with Christian." And Mahatma Gandhi looked into the face of this particular missionary and said, "Yes, I love Christ, but I don't like his Christians, because his Christians do not behave like him." He says, "I love and follow everything about Christ, but I don't want to be a Christian, because the Christians are unlike Christ." And what he says is truly what is happening in our days. The same Christians you see in church, that the same ones you meet them in the workplace, and they are fighting each other. And it's very strange that Muslims, Islamic people, live together. You never go to a mosque and see somebody, a Muslim, fighting the other. But it's the only place in the church where somebody doesn't want to stay with someone. He says, "I like Christ." He says, "I like Christ." But it's because of the Christians, because they don't behave and live like Christ. Malani Prayer Center, these five principles are about to change your life for good. Never forget about it, and your life will never be the same. If you're happy, shout, "I receive it."
I receive it.
Number one, the first biblical principle speaks about a woman who had, today I'm not preaching about the woman's story, it's a whole sermon altogether, but I'm using that one as the principle from Jesus Christ. It speaks about a woman who had 10 silver pieces, 10 coins, 1, 2, 3, 10. And the Bible says, and she lost one. And when she lost one, Jesus gave her the principle of life. The first thing the Bible said, Jesus Christ said, she will do is that she will light up a lamp. Now your first biblical principle is that the lamp there is the word of God. Live by the word of God. When you read Psalm 119, verse 105, it makes a statement over there. It says, somebody, let's read it together. Wait. So your first biblical principle in order for you to live a good life is the word of God. Live by the word of God. It says she lights a lamp. And the word of God says, his word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. Church of God, hear me. Never be a Christian without reading the word of God. The word of God is the principles you follow in your life. The word of God improves your daily living. When you meet an obstacle on the way, the answer to your obstacle is from the word of God. You can move up and down, jump up and down, but if you don't have the word of God with you, if the word of God is my light, then it means anytime I get to a place of darkness, if I have the word of God, it's going to be my torchlight. When the word of God comes over my life, I can hear different stories on the news, but I will go into the word of God and I will ask God, what is your word telling me? Because what is on the news can be contrary to the word of God. Right now, listen to me, the world has come to a point where everybody is blaming each other. Right now, because of the economy of the United Kingdom, they are blaming because they are in the European Union. So people in the same party, Conservative Party, people in the same party are fighting among themselves. Some are saying we are struggling because we are in Europe. And some are saying we are better off in Europe. Which means the policies and the principles of this life will not take you anywhere. But where you have the answer, where you have the straight answer to your destiny, is the word of God. Never forget to study your Bible. One thing that we are printing out in Lambi Prayer Center is that we are about to print out a particular sheet to everybody, and it's called Reading the Bible in 1 Year. And we're giving you the chapters for each day and every day. So from 1st of January to the 1st of December, if you can go through all, by the time the year goes to an end, you'll finish the Bible back to back. Because we want to develop people who will walk with the Word of God. Jesus, when he came, every time he speaks, you hear Jesus quoting from the Old Testament. Even he himself was the power, the Son of God, how to study and read. If you don't know, if you are listening here and you don't know the Word of God, you're in a big problem. Why? Because Satan also knows the Word of God. When Satan met Jesus, he said to Jesus, "As you are standing on top of this building, fall down, because it is written that his angels will hold you." How did Satan know? I said, how did Satan know that it is written? Because he too, he knows the word. So if you are a Christian who doesn't know the word, he sits down, look at you, and laugh at you. But I speak over your life. May God give you the energy. Somebody hear me? One of the things that the enemy uses to fight the word of God is that the enemy makes sure you don't have the energy to study the word of God. You can read a long message on WhatsApp. You can read somebody's post on Facebook. You can follow somebody on Instagram. But when it comes to your word of God, somebody can sit on Facebook and read what everybody is saying and connect one and two together. But when you hold your Bibles, you say, I don't understand. Listen to me. Make an effort to open your Bible every day. And if you can't even do anything at all, open a Psalms and read it. When you read it, you talk about God. Let this word become alive and active in my life. If the word of God is a lamb, you know a lamb. A lamb. Let me tell you something. When you speak about a lamb, a lamp is like a lantern. By now, if you're here, I know that you know a lantern, except only the people who were born in maybe 1985 who don't know a lantern. A lantern have kerosene inside, have something inside. Then you take the fire, and the fire will bring the light. Every light you see has fire. This light you see right now, there is fire inside. So if the word of God is like a lamp, and the word of God is inside of me, I move about with the fire of God. So when I move about with the fire of God, when the devil is coming around me, he can't come close because I'll be untouchable, because the fire is all around me. Somebody shout the word of God. Now, let's see another scripture. Job chapter 41 verse 9, also about the word of God. Out of his mouth, give me the KJV so that to be very, very clear. Out of his mouth, that's right. Out of his mouth go burning lamps. Somebody hear me? The mouth of God, when the Lord speaks the word of God, what is it? What is it?
Fire.
Burning lamps. So every now and then, the word of God coming is fire. So if the word of God is inside of you, you are a burning lamp. You are on fire. So when sickness comes, your fire burns the sickness. And sparks of fire leap out. Someone say, may the word of God stay in my heart. In Jesus' name. Now let's go to the second life principle. The second thing that he says in the same scripture says, and she sweeps the room clean. So the next step is that leave a clean life. Someone say,
leave a clean life.
Say,
I will live a clean life.
Yeah, there's a great statement that is always being said. It says, there is none righteous and nobody is perfect. And how can I be perfect? Somebody hear me? Yes, it's true in the Bible. It says, there is nobody who is righteous. He said, even your righteousness is like a filthy rag. It's not even a rag. Do you know a rag? A rag is always filthy, it's already filthy. But it says, if you try to become even righteous, it's like a filthy rag. But you know something? It goes on to say, but be ye holy, just as your Father is holy. So he knows your righteousness. When you try, it will only be like a filthy rag, but try. Do you know the kind of person God doesn't like? It's somebody who have sat up and said to myself, I will not change. The moment you make your mind and say, I will not change, it means you are telling God, God, you have no influence over me. But the moment you do everything out of reverence, it means you respect God. God is always close to people who are respecting to him or who respect him. So you strive to lead a holy life. Listen, nobody is perfect, but all of us is in the perfecting process. I said, all of us is on the perfecting process. Listen, if there is something that you are doing by now, by the grace of God, everybody here, God has given us great conscience. We know what is good and what is bad. Listen, the greatest gift God has given to human beings, the greatest gift God has given to us, the greatest gift is the gift of self-will. I said, the greatest gift, the difference between you and the cow, and the difference between you and the sea is the gift of self-will. For the sea, you can control the sea. But for you, God has left you alone for you to decide things for yourself. Because God loves you so much and he trusted you so much for him to give you a mind of your own. So God has given you the gift and the power of self-will. You need to strive hard to follow his principles and to follow everything that he's telling you. The power of self-will is this. Many people sit down and say, God, if you know that we were going to sin and we are going to sin, why didn't you make us like a remote control? So that you say that, hey, go here, don't go here, eat this, don't. Listen to me. The moment God makes you like a remote control, he is not God anymore. It means you are going to only serve him because he's controlling you. But God wants you to serve him from your own will, from your own heart, from your own mind, so that you will know that truly you respect him greatly. Don't you know that even sometimes when you have children, sometimes you just leave them to see how they behave themselves? Because, hear me, otherwise it will be like God is bribing you. And it will be an insult to God. It's the same insult that Satan insulted God about Job. Let me tell you. God is having a meeting with his children. And whilst God is having the meeting, a stranger appears. And the stranger is called Satan. Somebody say, God forbid. I can't hear somebody. Elbow your neighbor. Elbow your neighbor. Say, my neighbor. Elbow your neighbor. Say, my neighbor. God forbid. Now hear me. God is having a meeting with his children. Then Satan appears. And God says, hey, what are you doing here, Satan? Satan says, from the to and fro movement of the world that I appear here. So even where God meets, Satan can come there. So don't be surprised when you are in the church and the devil comes there. But you know the good news. Satan can come there, but he can't touch anybody. So it's like, Satan, you are here with my children, no problem. It's a Satan. Then God and Satan begin to have a conversation. And say, Satan, have you seen the guy sitting there? His name is called Job. Satan, have you considered my servant Job? Do you know the answer Satan gives? Satan tells God, oh, by you, God, you have blessed him and his life is moving forward. Because you have put a hedge fence of protection against him. Wait. God asked Satan, have you seen Job? Say yes. He says, can you touch him? He said, but God, you have put a hedge fence of protection against him. Do you know that meaning? It means every day Satan goes there to try Job. But when he gets there, there is a hedge fence. So how did Satan know that Job has a hedge fence around him? Because he tried the other being. Somebody, God is about to put a hedge fence of protection on your children, on your life, on your health, or whatever that belongs to you. It's about to protect you. Somebody said, Satan! The answer Satan gave to God, it was an insult. Don't know the meaning. It means Job is only serving you because his life is moving well. So God, you think you are God. He's only serving you because you are bribing him with good riches. Then God said, I'm going to show you that this guy by Job will still love me in spite of. He said, Satan, take away his money. Take away his car. Take away his children. Take away his designer clothes. And let me see whether he will love me or not. But you know the good thing about God.
A human being, you can make a mistake.
Forget about it. Run ahead. And somebody, you will move forward. The scripture on there. I have just 15 minutes to finish. The scripture on there is Psalm 24, verse 3. Psalm 24, verse 3. And I'll go to the last three. Psalm 24, verse 3. Psalm 24, verse 3. Now let's read together. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? For he that hath clean and pure. It's okay, hear me. Now hear me. So how can you ascend to the holy hill of God? You have to get the clean hands and a pure soul. Okay, now somebody hear me. Okay. Do you know that the Bible uses the word a clean hands? Do you know the meaning for clean hands? When I go out there and I take soil, my hands are dirty. But if I get the wisdom and I get to the washroom and I wash my hands become clean. So anytime God is checking your hands, he doesn't check what you used your hand to do yesterday. He checks your hands. Have not been dirty before. He said, if it can be dirty, but so long as you can come out your consciousness and say to yourself, enough is enough. Let me wash my hands. Let me live a good life. Let me stop the old sins. Let me move forward. And you can accept the person again. Number three. So the first one, light the lamp. Number two, sweeps. And the third one is search. Somebody say search. And how do we search? This is what is important. We search by prayer and fasting. Somebody say search. Yeah. I want you to scream search for 3 times. Search for 3 times. Let's go. One more time. One more time. Listen to me. This is where it's very, very important. Number one, you need to always get time and access your life. And you say to yourself, how I was doing last year, how am I doing this year? You have to do a soul searching. Search yourself. Now, how do you search? This is what is very important. Prayer and fasting. It's very dangerous for you to live a life without prayer. Church of God, hear me. I beg you, at least every day, in the morning, spend time. Instead of you rushing and running to go to work, listen to me. Wake up early. Give God 30 minutes of your time. Sit up and say, God, I thank you for the day. Protect me for the day. Deliver me for the day. Take evil people from my life today. Let the day bring me good news. Speak to the dead. Somebody say prayer.
Prayer.
Say prayer.
Prayer.
And fasting. Listen, do you know that Jesus Christ? Jesus is very powerful. One day, I will preach a sermon I call Jesus Christ. I will teach you about Jesus. Jesus was so powerful, but every night the Bible said he will go on top of the mountain and he will pray. Even Jesus. That's how the Bible said, even Jesus. Elbow your neighbor. I said, elbow your neighbor, say, even Jesus. So me every day when I wake up, I said to myself, have I prayed? How many minutes am I praying for? How many hours? Because even Jesus, the all powerful, he prayed. He that he knew his destiny, he prayed. Somebody said, God, give me the power.
God, give me power.
The power to pray.
The power to pray.
Now let's see something from Matthew chapter 26, verse 41. Matthew chapter 26, verse 41. Let's read it. It says, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. Let's do it together. One, two, three, let's go.
Watch and pray.
Finish it then. But the flesh is weak. So he knows, hear me? He knows you try to pray, you are struggling. But make sure you pray. Otherwise, you will fall into temptation. I speak on somebody. I take you out of temptation. I said, I take you out of temptation. When he was showing us to pray, he says, and lead us not into. Temptation means struggle. Somebody can put you into trouble. But today, by the blood of Jesus, I take you out of.
stand a day without prayer. I want you to always feel guilty in the day you didn't pray. If you are me, if I've not prayed in a day, it's like I'm missing something. Until my consciousness tells me you've not prayed yet. I make sure I always pray not less than 3 to 4 hours a day. Because prayer is what will keep you. Everybody hear me very well. You know how to feed your body with food. What your spirit wants is prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting the word of God. So if your spirit is not having it, your spirit is having koshoko. You know koshoko? Koshoko is feeding deficiency. When a child is young and they don't eat well, they have deficiency and their stomach becomes a pregnant woman. So if you don't feed your spirit with prayer, spiritually, you are like koshoko. That Koshoko word is a Ghanaian word. It's from Ghana. And the whole world has borrowed it. So tell me. So imagine your spirit is not strong. Can somebody hear me? When the devil is about to attack you, they weigh your spirit first. Never forget this. When they want to draw trouble at you, before they send an agent to your house, they say, let's weigh this person's spirit. So when they come and there's no prayer and fasting in you, that's what it's lightweight. Let's throw. But from today, let me prayer center. That's what we have to pray in this church. So that even if you have not prayed the whole week, when you come to service any day, there's power to increase the muscles of your spirit. Now, last 9 minutes, let's go to another scripture, KJV. Luke 18, verse 1. KJV, Luke 18, verse 1. Somebody hear me? Then he spoke a parable to them. Oh. Hey, what are you doing to me, my brother? Luke 18, verse 1. Then he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray. Give me KJV. Now, everybody, let's go. 1, 2, 3, let's go. Continue.
Trusted friends.
Hear me? If you have many friends, You are setting yourself up for trouble.
Yes.
Because just talk about, hear me. Every friend you have also has another friend.
Yes.
So when you think you have a friend and say, my friend, let me tell you my secret. After you tell your friend the secret, this other friend will hear the secret.
Church,
hear me. Get few trusted friends. The problem in our world right now is who is your friend?
Tell me,
in other, don't you know that when you have so many friends and something about you comes out, you begin to sit down. Which one said it? Which one said it?
But Church of God, hear me. Get only two friends. Two friends you believe you trust.
Get two. Forget about others. Friendship will not help you. When you are young, you think friendship is good. But when you grow to some age, you know that friendship can never help you. Friendship will destroy your life. Be careful of friends. I said be careful of friends. Let me tell you something. Let me show you signs of friends you need to run away from. Signs of wrong friends. There are three. Three signs of wrong friends. When you know this, run away from them. I said, when you know this one, run away from them. Say, my neighbor. When you get this one, run away from them. Now. Yeah, number one. When you have anybody around you who is not happy for your greatness, and not happy for this, let me talk. They are not, if you know it already, why do you still have these things around you? Keep quiet. Listen. They are not happy for your good news. They always talk you down. Anytime you want to do something good, they try to tell you you cannot make it. They discourage you. Run away from them. Number two, when you have somebody around you who is always bitter, they complain about everything, complain about other people, they talk about other people, and they don't talk about themselves. But every day, they are pointing to you other people's faults. They cannot help you. Run away from them. Because after they talk about other people, the next time, they will talk about you. Elbow your neighbor. Say, my neighbor. I said, elbow your neighbor. Say, my neighbor. Be very careful about those people. And you see them being friends with your enemy. Listen, I have one friend of mine, Prophet David, the one who was here last year, Prophet David. And where he does is they do their church, there was one guy that had a problem with David's senior pastor. So that guy left the church and that guy was talking bad about the church. But there was one guy in the church that is very, very close to David and the senior pastor. So one guy is in the church, very close to David and very close to the senior pastor. But one other guy left and was talking about the church. 6 months after, the guy that was close to David and the senior pastor also left. And just on Facebook 2 days ago, I was there. Then I saw the guy that used to be very, very close to David. Very, very close now to the first guy who left. I saw the picture, I screenshot it. I said, let me check something. He said, my brother, we're in trouble. Do you know the picture? It's like example, this brother used to be in the church and he left a long time ago. And right now, I had Abraham with me. So right now, he has left the church a long time ago, talking about the church and everything. And right now, I have Abraham with me, who is very close to me, a prophet, Ryan. But after about 6 months, he too left. Then after some time, I go on Facebook, and I see the two of them. Talking together, and even when this one travels to London, he stays in this one's house. I saw the picture, I sent it to David, and I said, David, let me show you something. He said, prophet, you need to pray for me, I'm in trouble. It's very dangerous.
Yes,
that's how the world has become. You don't know who's going to be your enemy tomorrow. tomorrow. The same person you are looking about with today, tomorrow you don't know. So be very careful with your life.
Am I giving order?
Oh, one, two, okay, third one. The last tip you have to get for my friend. Anybody who pushes you away from God. Anybody who pushes you away from God. When you're going to church, they tell you, oh, don't go to church. You want to give God offerings, they don't give God offering. When you're praying, oh, you pray too much. Anybody who talks you away from God cannot be your friend. Now, let me show you some scriptures that will surprise you right now. Let me show you some scriptures that will surprise you right now. Now, let's go to Proverbs 22, verse 24. I have 5 minutes to finish. Proverbs 22, verse 24. Oh, everything I tell you, give me NIV before I tell you to change it. Okay, please. NIV. A man, okay, give me, yes. A man of many friends may come to what? Go to KTV, the same place KTV, and see something. Church, be very careful. A man. Okay. I think, give me the NIV. I don't know the scripture. Give me the NIV still. A man of many companions may come to who? If you have so many friends, you will be ruined.
Yes.
It's in the Bible. I said it's in the Bible. Yes, everything. I said everything in this world is in the Bible. A man of many friends. It means you will fall down. You'll be destroyed. Your life will be in a mess. And you have many friends. Let's take another scripture. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 24. Give me 22, verse 24. Now, this one, give me the KJV, let me see. Oh, that's right. Make no friendship with an angry man. And it's about to blow your mind. Anywhere you could just tell them that you heard it from your church. Anybody who becomes angry, don't be close to them, right?
Yes.
Somebody say anger.
Anger.
Somebody say anger.
Anger.
I'm about to tell you a secret, never forget about it. Say anger.
Anger.
Say anger.
Anger.
Now hear me. Say anger.
Anger.
When you have anger, right? Say anger.
Anger.
Put D in front of anger. What is it? Put D in front of anger. What is it?
Anger.
Anytime there is anger, there is
anger.
Never forget about this. This one is for free. No offering. Anytime there is anger, it will end up into danger. Never forget about it. They go hand in hand. When there is anger, there is danger. Never forget. I come to show you another one that will surprise you. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 20, then you go to the last one, half 3 minutes to finish. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 28. Proverbs 16, verse 28. A perverse, give me the KJV, let me see something. Give me the KJV first. Let me see something. Okay, give me the NIV like that. Good. A perverse man stirs up dissension. I like this place. Let's continue. One, two, three, let's go. When anytime somebody brings you a gossip, the first thing to tell them is that, where did you get it from? When somebody brings you a gossip and they tell you, this is what I heard, but I won't tell you where I got it from, it means they are part of it. I said, it means they are. It means they are. When you hear anything and they can't tell you the source, it people that are part of it. The next thing I want you to know, when somebody comes to tell me, because this is what I say. I say to the person, why was my enemy very comfortable in talking to you? Wait. Okay, you keep telling me that this person is talking about me to you. But why was this person so comfortable in talking to you? So it means you and the person are poor. Never forget about this. Never forget about this. Last one, let's go. The last one. Good family. To get on top of the five basic principles, you may God cover you and bring you to good family. Now, somebody asks me, where does the family come from? The Bible says she called the friends and the neighbors. The neighbor over there in the Greek is called gentle. And the gentle over there means background. And you know that your background is your family. May God surround you with good family members. Yeah.
Church of God, hear me. Most of the issues we are going through is family issues.
There's a lady who came to this church. She came to see me on Tuesday. And she said something that blew my mind. She said, Prophet, everybody hear me very well. You know what she said to me? She said, Prophet, my mom and my sister are living in Africa. And they were renting from a place. And the place they were renting from, it was too expensive. So I said to myself, let me go and buy a land. When I buy a land, I'll build a house on it and everything. So to let me go, she got the money, sent the money to the sister. For the sister to buy the land, the sister bought the land. When the sister bought the land, then she also gave money for the sister for them to complete the house, all her money. So when the mother and the sister were about to move into the house, is when she remembered, my sister, I'll come to send somebody to you so that the person will come and collect the papers of their land. The person went there and the sister, the junior sister, said to her, I won't give you any paper of the land. She said, she even thought the sister was joking, but that close. She said, what are you doing? He said, I won't give you that. Then she said, okay, but they want to answer one question. That land that I sent you the money to buy and everything, whose name is on it? At least, if it's mama's name, I don't care. He said, whose name? She said, it's my name. He said, at least we are fine for mama, so that mama is not there. He said, no, it's my name. Then what happened was that this lady now sent some elders to her sister and said, listen, the document, they want to take it to the lands and registry so that they change the name and put the lady in London here, the name, because for her. The sister told the elder, the sister in Africa, told the elders, tell my sister in London that if she doesn't want to become mad, yes, she comes to this church. I don't see her here, that's why I'm saying it. She maybe should go on Thursday. She said, if you tell her that if she doesn't want to become mad, she should leave me alone. Her junior sister. She told me, I opened my mouth for 5 minutes in the office. I said, what kind of world do we live in? What kind of world do we live in? There are two things I said to her. God will remember you. God will remember her. Wow. She doesn't know what to do. She's going crazy. Imagine this London, this cold weather, this winter, working in the hospital, up and down, up and down, up and down. You guess what you said? Go, foundation, wall. He says, why have you put your name on it? I said, but you are in London, so by tell her that if she tries, she will. She said that she doesn't want to become mad, she didn't try. Yes, what? Yes. Somebody hear me? Be very, very careful. There's a family I pray for. There's somebody in the family. The men in the family, when they get to the age of 32, they become mad. I went to their house. I poured olive oil. The day I poured olive oil in the house, 5 dogs in the house died. 5 dogs. All of them died. I poured olive oil there. And I said to them, the dog that has died is a sign that something has been broken. I said to them, your great-grandfather made a covenant with a dog and destroyed the destiny of the man because he wanted to become the greatest person in the family and nobody after. It's a prophet issue. Everything, men, 32, they become mad. The day the dog died, the guy that was in the mental asylum in Ghana, all of them started coming out.
there are things in families that it takes the hand of God to deliver. Now, last one, everybody be on your feet and let's read this scripture. I'm done. Do you love the teaching?
Yes.
Imagine you get all these teachings on your life will move forward.
Yes.
That's why we're in Landing Prayer Center. Lamentations chapter 5 verse 7. See something there right now. Lamentations chapter 5 verse 7. Let's go. 1, 2, 3, let's go. Wait, oh. It's in the Bible. Oh. You know, I will be showing you things in the Bible that you put your head and go and hit on the wall. Read it again. Our fathers sinned, they are no more, and we bear their punishment. But today, so hear me, the last one is for you to get into a good family. Listen to me. It means that some families, some fathers, ancestors have sinned, and they are gone, but people are struggling. But I stand on the altar of Landing Prayer Center.